Hello everyone, I'm delighted to be kicking off the final day of this event. I've followed lots of it throughout the last few days and it's been really nice, enjoyed it and learned a lot. So welcome everyone. Today we're going to look at creative and critical thinking skills with the Life Competencies Framework. Now, you will probably have been hearing a lot about this throughout the last few days. Some of you probably be very familiar with it already, but I'm just going to do a little brief introduction to what it is before we look at activities connected to it for those of you who are not familiar, and also for those of you who need a refresher. So let's begin. Okay, so here's our agenda, just to give you an idea. We're going to look at what we mean by it. We're going to look at the framework as an overview to see how it all fits together, and then we're going to focus on these two particular competencies because I think we've been hearing a lot of them, and because they are very related to 21st century skills that you're very familiar with, I'm sure. And then we're going to look at the activity cards that are really, really useful and free tool that you can download and use straight away in your classroom. So we're going to examine a few of those and see how we might use them in our classrooms. All right. Okay, so 21st century skills. Obviously, we've heard a lot about these. Depending on how long you've been teaching, you might have been hearing about these for decades even. And so we have the four C's. Now, I can't see the chat box, all right, but I still want us to share ideas. So you'll be sharing ideas with each other throughout this session. So what you can do to share with each other is in the chat box, what are the four C's? Start typing that while I go through them. And yeah, four C's plus is what we're going to be looking at today. So I'm sure I've seen you all in action. I've been watching the chat box as I've been watching the session, so I know you're pretty fast. So what have we got? We've got critical thinking, we've got creativity, communication, and collaboration. Okay, so these are the four C's we've heard a lot about over the last however many years for 21st century skills. What we're going to do today is look at how Cambridge has built upon this foundational idea and spread out into competencies covering more areas, but also in a lot more depth, and also how they've made it very, very applicable to the classroom. So it's not just this vague idea, all right? We're gonna look at how these are broken down. Now, also bear in mind that your students were born in the 21st century, without a doubt, okay? Most of you will have spent probably your entire adulthood in the 21st century. If I repeat this session in 10 years, I'll be talking to teachers that were born in the 21st century. So at what point do we start looking at 22nd century skills? What I'm trying to say is 21st century skills is not a new idea, and many of them arose within the 20th century, but it's about preparing our students for the future, okay? So we've still got a bit of 21st century to go. So life competencies then. If you ever look at any Cambridge materials, or if you look at the Life Competencies Framework, you're going to see this little symbol throughout with our all of our new material now that's coming out. Anyone who attended Graham's session on impact yesterday, he mentioned the fact that more and more of our material is being closely aligned to the life competencies, and these competencies are integrated into the material, whether it's for primary or for adults, it's all there. And also mentioned the very exciting idea that our assessment is going to be aligned to this. And I've done quite a few sessions on how to prepare students for exams and assessment using the life competency. So it's not an add-on, it's something that's already within the material that can be further explored. Okay, so these are the two brochures for critical thinking and creative thinking. All of our brochures for life competencies are available on our website. Perhaps one of our kind moderators might put in the link in the chat box at some point so you can access it easily. But if you just go to our website, you can download all of these, and I'll show you a few more things you can download a bit later. Okay, but first of all, we need to think about what we mean by life competency, because we've talked about 21st century skills. You'll have heard a lot about life skills, So why is Cambridge using this term competency when it is quite difficult to say? I stumble over it a lot. Why don't we just say skills? Well, this is explained in more detail in each of those booklets and in a great deal of depth in our introductory booklet. But in a nutshell, a competency is more than just a skill. It's the combination of knowledge, skill, and attitude. Okay, so the knowledge to do something, the knowledge that's required, the skill through practice, and the attitude, what you bring to it. And the way I try to explain this to my teachers and my students is to get them to think of something they have learned to do or something they are learning to do that's not connected to language learning or English, just to sort of put that to one side. So I remember asking a class about a year ago, maybe a bit more, and one teacher said, I remember learning to ride a bike. Okay, so it's not just skill, is it? You need knowledge before you even get on the bike. Okay, you need to understand how the bike works, where to put your feet, what to do with your feet, what to do with your arms. You need road awareness if you're going to ride on the road. So there's a lot of knowledge there. Then the skill comes through practice, because of course you're going to fall off. And I was a bike rider and I fell off an awful lot, even as an accomplished adult bike rider. You're gonna fall off a lot, you're gonna pick yourself up and start again. Keep practicing, okay? Now, when you're trying to learn to ride a bike, especially when you're quite small, you get frustrated, yeah? And you think, I can't do this, I don't want to do this. I remember my nephew, when he was about 5 years old, throwing his bike on the floor, I'm rubbish at this, I don't want to do this anymore, okay? Then he came around, picked himself up, got back on his bike, and kept going. Okay, so it's about the attitudes, but it's understanding that sometimes we need help with those attitudes as well. So all of these three things together combined create a competency: the knowledge, the skill, and the attitude. So it's a little bit more than generic life skills, and that's why we've called it competency. Okay, so this is the framework. These are the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 competencies, plus we have a brochure on emotional development as well. But you'll see that doesn't have a little colourful box. Emotional development, digital literacy, and discipline knowledge, in our case, English language learning and teaching, are the foundation level. So they're built into each competency. But emotional development does have its own competency brochure as well. But you can see, as well as the 4 C's, we've got learning to learn, very important, and we've also got social responsibilities, which is, as we know, very, very important, and we've seen a lot about that sort of thing throughout the last few days as well. Digital literacy used to be a separate competency, but as we move further into the 21st century, and certainly over the last couple of years, we've understood that actually it's an integrated part of learning and communication. It's not something separate, okay? It's not something we need to teach, because learners are doing it throughout their lessons naturally, okay? So that informs the competencies. We've got a lot of information on it, but we don't need to treat it as a separate competency. For digital migrants like me, oh yes, yeah. There's quite a lot I needed to learn. But our students, no, we don't need to do that. Okay, so when we break these down then, we've got a little definition for each of these and the brochure for each of these. So you can see the definitions there. You'll see that in each brochure. And this is interesting. So there was a huge survey done over 70 countries around the world. And this was some of the information that came out. You'll find this on our website as well. So only 38% of teachers think that they develop their learners' life competency in almost all of their lessons, okay? But about half of them feel that they can integrate these life competencies into the lesson to some extent, but 11% of teachers report that they don't effectively do this. So we're gonna look at ways that we can help you to do this. Now, one of the ways, of course, is by integrating these into our materials, all right? But if you're not using our particular material for a particular lesson, or you're using an older edition or a book that isn't yet aligned, here are ways we can certainly help you. All right, so one other thing to note, that it's the entire learning journey. So from pre-primary, kindergarten, through primary, secondary, higher education, adult, and also at work. So we can use these to help you in your professional development as well, which I think is really exciting. Okay, so I mentioned before, we've got the introductory booklet. We've got each of the competencies. You don't need all the 7 booklets. There they are. But if you're only teaching young learners, that's the booklet you want, okay? Because it's got all the competencies for pre-primary and primary all in one place. The same with the teenage learners and the same with the adult learners as well, all right? And that's how the activity cards are organized. So you don't have to read through all of this material. You just grab the booklet that's useful for you in your classroom. So we're going to look at critical thinking first of all, okay? And this is where you can start sharing your ideas in the chat box. What does it mean to you? We don't have a lot of time. And as I say, I can't see the chat box. So I'm just going to bring up some information here. There we go. So the ability to engage in reflective and independent thinking, reasoning skills, identifying, analyzing, we're thinking of Bloom's taxonomy now, aren't we, I think, solving problems systematically rather than intuition or instinct, something like that, okay? And this, very important, rigorously questioning ideas and assumptions, not just accepting them at face value. This, we've heard the term active learner a lot, haven't we? Okay, this is very important. We're developing critical thinking skills, we are creating active learners, because they're very involved with their own learning, they're questioning things, all right? That's crucial. So if we have a look at our competencies for critical thinking, you'll see the same kind of breakdown for all of our competencies, okay? We see the competency is critical thinking, then that's broken down into 3 core areas. Some of the competencies are broken down into 4 core areas, most of them are 3. So here we've got 3, okay? Understanding and analyzing ideas and arguments, evaluating ideas and arguments, solving problems and making decisions. So you can see how each of those builds on the previous one. And remember I talked about that learning journey, okay? So these core areas are the same for each stage of that journey. So for pre-primary or for adult or for at work, we've got those core areas, but within those, they are broken down into components, and those components build up the learner's skills throughout each stage of that journey, okay? So these components, when we break it down, help us to create material around that that develops these specific skills. So we're not just going, oh, let's do some critical thinking. It's quite big, quite vague. We're really analyzing it, breaking it down into core areas, then components, taking those components, looking at the stage of learning, looking at the language they're learning, and then building material around that, activities around that, can-do statements around that to help our learners achieve these goals at each stage. So that's the research and what we've put in to help you, to help your learners develop these skills. Okay. So we can see, we break it down there. We've got example can-do statements for each stage. Okay, so I think this might be for primary, okay, and relating it to different aspects of language learning. And then we've got example language. Now, that doesn't mean to say we have to teach that language, but it is an example of the language we might be using or exploring when we are doing, when we're doing some critical thinking development. All right, there we go. Oh, what happened there? This matters. Okay, so that's what it looks like when you open the brochure, okay, for critical thinking. Or if you've got, and I think this is from the young learners one, if you've got the young learners one, when you turn to the critical thinking page and you see pre-primary and primary, then you'll see it broken down like this, okay? There we go. Components, example can-do statements, and example language. All right, so all of you, I am sure, will know what this is. Pop it in the chat box, remind each other, remind our newer teachers who might not be familiar with this, all right? So we think about Bloom a lot as teachers. We think about critical thinking, we think about higher order thinking skills and lower order thinking skills, all right? And then again, something worth breaking down, looking at synonyms. What does remembering mean? How do we show that we're remembering? So all of this informs it as well, okay? And with some of our materials, I think with our Adult Unlock series and PRISM, we will see within the unit that these lower order and higher order thinking skills don't need to be taught in order to climb the pyramid of Bloom. You will see 1, 2, 3 different skills, lower order and higher order, within one activity. So we can develop multiple skills at the same time. Right at the top is creating. There's another reason I've decided to show you this, okay, is because creative thinking and critical thinking do overlap with each other. That's why we like looking at them together, or I like looking at them together, because when we reach the peak of Bloom, really high, the highest order thinking skill is creativity and creative thinking. So the two align very well with each other. Okay, so let's do an activity, shall we? And here we've got an activity card. So before we think about the activity itself, I want to have a look at these cards. Now, you can go, again, hopefully we can pop a link in the box there to download these cards. So you can download them as a set. Young learners, all the competencies. Teens, all the competencies. And adults, all the competencies. You can download them. You can use them digitally, or like I have, or you can print them off. You can laminate them, you can take them into the class, and we'll look at different ways to use them at the end of the session. But first things first. So this is what one of them looks like. You can see here it's a young learner's activity card, and it's critical thinking, of course. So just to talk you around how it looks. You've probably seen this before, or one of these before, but let's just break it down. So we've got our competency here. This is critical thinking. Okay. Then we have our core area. Okay, so this core area of critical thinking is understanding and analyzing ideas and arguments. So this will help you choose. You want to do critical thinking today. Which sort of core area do I want to do? So in this right-hand corner, you'll see the core area, and then we'll see our component. So this is recognizing patterns and relationships. The bottom, yes, I've got the right level. And then an online teaching tip, which is very nice, in case you have to go online. All right, and so our activity here is it's recognizing patterns in a relationship. We're looking at Venn similarities. So if you're doing any comparisons, oh, this would be a great one to bring into the classroom, okay? You'll see a lot with critical thinking of using graphic organizers. So you'll see brainstorming tools, stuff like that. They're brilliant for developing critical thinking skills. Here we've got our Venn diagram, which looks simple, but actually has a level of complexity to it. Okay, so this is really good for getting students to think about processing, analyzing vocabulary, not just remembering it, lower order thinking skill, but thinking about how it works and how it interacts with other ideas. Okay, so when we're learning sets of vocabulary, lexical sets, so here we've got animals, could be anything at all. All right, you can get your students to choose two items, use a Venn diagram to compare the items, okay? But instead of just thinking, they're putting their ideas on paper, they're using this Venn diagram to help them. Once they're familiar with the idea of a Venn diagram, you can reuse that. They'll see it in maths as well. CLIL is a great tool for developing competencies, and particularly critical thinking. Maths, science, things like that. Okay, let's have a look at how I've used it in the classroom though, and we're going to verge into creativity a little bit here. Venn diagram. It's an empty Venn diagram. Okay, so we're going to think sort of along primary levels. This is an activity I did a long time ago. Anyone that's taught comparatives, adjectives, so it's, we're not doing animals, we're doing adjectives here, we'll be familiar with the types of things our students say, or what we ask them to say when we ask them to compare two things. So this is very typical, and it takes me back to my days before we had all digital stuff, and I was using flashcards, okay, and I had animal flashcards in the classroom, and I wanted to practice animal vocabulary, but mostly introduce and practice comparative adjectives. So I had this, And I had this. And in the chat box, what was I hoping to achieve? Or what did the material want me to achieve? What sentence would we say? An elephant is, hopefully you'll have put in the chat box or someone, an elephant is bigger than a mouse. Or a mouse is smaller than an elephant. Fantastic. Okay. All right. That's one way to do it. Okay. How does the Venn diagram come into this? Well, when we compare things, quite often, because we're looking at comparative adjectives, our focus is on looking at differences, right? Elephant is bigger than a mouse. Mouse is smaller than an elephant, blah, blah. But what you can do is put them in there and look at similarities and differences. Because when we compare things in real life, we look at things that are the same. So let's think about what's the same. We've got elephant, we've got mouse. What's the same? What's different? That's something, and we can use our Venn diagram to do that, can't we? Okay. Now, if we're looking at comparatives, and this is a little bit out of the box thinking, and we're going into creativity a little bit, and I'll be honest with you, this is because I made a mistake. Remember I said I was using flashcards? All right. Well, I might not be the most organized person in the world, and you've got lots of different flashcards, haven't you? And I picked them all up, and I ran into class, and I was pulling cards out, and thinking they were all animals. I was like, compare this animal and this animal. Compare this animal and this animal. And I held up an elephant and I thought, well, I wonder what animal's going to be next. And it wasn't. I mixed up my food cards with my animal cards. So I had an elephant and I had a pizza. And I just thought, oh, let's just give it a go, shall we? Let's see what they come up with. And they did. They came up with some brilliant ideas. Okay, so in the chat box, let's compare an elephant and a pizza, similarities or differences. So we could use our Venn diagram here, all right? Why is that useful? Why did I think let's just go for it? It wasn't because I was embarrassed and I wanted to say, oh, let's pretend I meant this. I just thought this is an opportunity to see if this works. We have to be a bit bold when we're teachers, and we do sometimes make mistakes, but this was one of the most fortunate mistakes I've made. Now, our students needed a bit more thinking time, so we're like, what now? But you know what? They really wanted to do this because it was unusual. It was different. They had to think hard. They had to be creative to come up with an idea, and they loved it, and it made it memorable. So we had a pizza is more delicious than an elephant. I did a follow-up question. I said, how do you know that? And they had to think again. And I went, oh, well, have you eaten an elephant? No, but I would imagine, or I think, why do you think, well, I know a pizza is really delicious, and I just imagine an elephant is not delicious. But they actually came up with lots and lots of different ideas. It took a lot longer, but they were engaged because we weren't just going through the motions. Because you know what? They'd never compared those things before. They compared an elephant and a mouse before, maybe not in English class, but it's so obvious, isn't it? And they already knew that language. They knew elephant, they knew mouse, they knew big, they knew the concept. So they weren't really learning or thinking about anything new or innovative. But when they had to think about comparing an elephant and a pizza, that really made them think hard. It made them engaged. It made them motivated. And it got them speaking, which was fantastic. So it doesn't have to be elephant and pizza. It can be anything. All I'm saying is take a risk in the classroom sometimes and creativity might follow. All right. So here's another example. I'm not going to go into too much detail because we do have to do creativity in a minute. But I just wanted to show you an example from teenage learners. So, however, I would adapt this. I would adapt this and have adapted this for my primary learners. Odd one out. OK, so we see odd one out. In fact, odd one out, we see in some of the YLE exams where they've got to choose vocabulary. So it's a good way of remembering and processing vocabulary. But there's lots of things you can do with odd one out, okay? And again, with critical thinking, it might not be the obvious thing, okay? So if you give your students a list and you mix up some vocabulary and you might say, okay, choose the odd one out, and we've got football, basketball, hockey, monkey, tennis. Which one's the odd one out? Very easy, it's monkey. But if you give them only the sports and get them to choose the odd one out based on some rationale that they've created and they have to justify it, that makes it a bit more interesting, doesn't it? Rather than just choose it. Obviously, you have to do the vocabulary first, make sure they're familiar with it. So you build up to that. So there's a lots you can do to play around with things like that. So they're thinking about it, they're giving their opinions, they're deciding, and they will all have different ideas, and that's absolutely fine, okay? So, you know, they can see that they're justifying their ideas, they can disagree with their partner, they give reasons, they argue about it, gets them thinking, forming their own opinions. All of that is really going a very long way to developing their skills. Okay, which brings us to creative thinking. As I said, the two overlap quite a lot. So, 14 minutes, I think we've got enough time. All right, here's a little definition. Now, there's been a lot of talk of creative thinking over the past few days and creativity and everything else. And it is quite hard to define. There are many, many definitions there. But this definition I like very much. The ability to generate new ideas, alternatives, or possibilities rapidly and elaborate on them. Okay, so you can see kind of how that fits in with critical thinking and the activities we've looked at just before there. And it doesn't have to be coming up with an original idea, and it doesn't have to be in a creative activity. Any of you who attended Herbert Pukta's session on creativity, he looked at how we could look at language creatively, even a gap fill, how we can do a gap fill creatively. Okay, it doesn't have to be in an art class, because lots of teachers say, well, it's all right for primary teachers, they do art, they do drama, I teach high school, I can't do that. Doesn't have to be connected to a creative activity or a creative lesson. If it can be, of course it can be, that's marvelous, all right? But it can be in any lesson at all. And there are many attributes to creative thinking, and that's a great starting point to thinking about how we can start to build up these skills, because we can focus on those attributes. Again, can't give you much time for this, but as I move to the next slide, what do you think some of the attributes of creative thinking could be? Pop them in the chat box, share them with each other. Okay, so as you do that, I'm going to bring them up and I'll talk a little bit about a couple of them. Some of them are very obvious and I think you'll definitely agree. There's your question mark, keep typing. Imagination, yeah, okay, great. So that's why we think of creativity with very young learners. They've got their active imaginations. They're into stories and drama and song and role play and all of this sort of stuff. It's a big part of it. And it's something we feel we might lose as we get older. It's still there, it just needs a little bit of a nudge. But it's not just imagination. Curiosity, we know curiosity is very important. It's there in our learners, with our young learners, it's really there in your face. Why? Let me touch this, let me do these things. With our older learners, again, needs a little bit of a nudge from us. Enjoying new things, okay. So if someone is already a good creative thinker, they already enjoy new things. So we have to broaden their horizons and get them to understand that new things are an opportunity, are exciting, and that will help to develop their creative thinking skills. Intrinsic motivation and creative thinking go together. So again, developing that, tapping into that motivation of our students. Cognitive flexibility. So this is where the overlap with critical thinking skills is very obvious. So being able to have flexible thinking skills. Divergent thinking. We'll look at that in a moment for those of you who are not sure what this is. And tolerance for ambiguity. All right. So very often, and this is one of the reasons why creative thinking development helps our students not be afraid of making mistakes. One of the reasons they're afraid of making mistakes is like, but what is the answer? I need to be correct. Whether it's language or something factual you're doing, quite often our students and our older students really don't like this ambiguity. But if we can develop a tolerance for it and we can develop our creative thinking skills, that helps us to open our minds to a growth mindset, learn more, okay? All right, so divergent thinking. This is an activity I bet loads of you have done in the classroom, okay? So the opposite of it is convergent thinking. finding one well-defined solution to a problem. Divergent thinking is the opposite. Like that, involves more creativity. So in other words, trying to find lots of different possible solutions to a problem or thinking outwards. All right. So again, science is brilliant to do, brilliant way of developing divergent thinking. But an activity that I did 20 years ago, and I bet loads of you have done it, maybe not with a paperclip, but it was in some resource book. It was a warmer, a filler, something like this. And it was find 20 different uses for a paperclip. You take a paperclip, something you've got in the office, you take a paperclip. It could be anything, but the paperclip was the thing. So that's an example of divergent thinking. You've got this one thing and you're looking at lots of different ways to use it. Okay, and it gets them really brainstorming, thinking creatively. What can we do with it? Okay, not just to clip paper together. What can you do with this thing? And get them working in pairs to bounce ideas off each other. So you're bringing in collaboration as well. All right, so that's an example of how we can bring divergent thinking in. Here's what it looks like in our framework. So again, our competency, core areas, components. So we start with preparing for creativity. Then we start generating ideas. Then we start implementing the ideas and our problem solving. Okay, here's an example. If you attended, I think it was Sarah and Alberto did one session about exam support and used this for teams, elaborating on and combining ideas. And it was the brain right. So I'd urge you to go and watch that session because it was really useful. And they went into more detail about how you could use this to help students prepare for exams. Okay, so I won't go into too much detail about that because that's outlined far better than I could do elsewhere. But again, we can see how all of this information helps us to make a decision on which of our activity cards we might want to use. Okay, here's one at the primary level, young learners. It's an easy one. Now, if you're teaching inquiry-based learning, this ties in wonderfully with your aims and your goals, okay? Because it's all about getting our students to ask questions, all right? You can bring this in any class that you're doing. It's a great idea. So the topic here is food, but whatever topic you are doing with your learners, and again, I would do this with teens, I would do this with adults, so don't be afraid to adapt. When introducing a topic, invite learners to ask you a question. Okay, now with our young learners, we might need to guide them a little bit more and start by asking them questions, but then just turn it over to them. Now it's your turn, you ask me a question. Then, of course, our next stage would be ask your partner a question. Ask the class a question, etc. So it's getting them to think a little bit deeper, creating questions, coming up with their own ideas. That is still creative. You'll notice the visuals there. The visuals help you enormously, all right? So whether you've got a course book page open with pictures of the vocabulary, or whether you're drawing something on the board, back in the day before we had all this digital support, it was me and the board. How many stick men did I draw on the board? I have no idea, but it helps. Any visual aid helps. Getting your students to ask you a question, forming that question, thinking of their own question. You can see here, it's at the first stage, preparing for creativity. Generating ideas, teams. And again, I'd use this with young learners. I'd use it with adults, but you'd modify how you set it up. What can you hear and smell in the picture? I absolutely love this idea because very often we're in a visual age now, aren't we? We use our smart boards. All of our learning materials are very colorful with amazing photographs, okay? And we ask our students, what can you see? Because we want to get from them what vocabulary they know, their ideas. We want to start getting them to ask questions, thinking a little bit deeper, but let's go beyond the visual. Let's get them to imagine they're there. What does it smell like? What sounds can you hear? What does it feel like? Maybe what does it taste like? Certainly if it's food. So you're getting them to just engage a little bit more with the picture. They have to use their imagination or their previous knowledge, but sometimes their imagination. They have to be creative. Maybe they don't have the exact vocabulary they want, so they have to be creative with the vocabulary. Okay, so this is a great activity that you could use in almost any lesson with almost any age. I absolutely love it. Okay, 5 minutes left. These are ways to foster creativity in your classroom. Okay, so remember the questions or asking your students what things smell like or feel like or sound like. Give you praise. Oh, and even with critical thinking about comparing an elephant and a pizza. Praise to creativity. Praise that creativity. Forget the language. Praise the out-of-the-box thinking. One of my favorite things in a lesson is to say, whoa, I love that idea. I've never heard that before. You've given me goose pimples. Okay, that's the best praise I feel like I can give a student, is to go, I love it. That sounds brilliant. Oh, I never thought of that. And your students then feel amazing. And then they feel inspired. And the other students feel inspired to come up with more ideas. The more ideas they've got, the more the creativity's flowing, the more confidence they have to just contribute to the class. Okay, these questions, we've talked about this already, okay? So I won't go into detail. I'll give you a chance to read that. Hopefully you can read it. I know the slides have been a little bit blurry, so I've tried to make it quite big. Being playful, no wrong answers. When we're being creative, when we're eliciting ideas, or we're playing with language even, no wrong ideas, no wrong answers. Diversity is key. Absurdity, if we can make them laugh, not laughing at, but laughing with. These are great ideas. What a brilliant idea. That made me laugh. It's such a great idea. You're so funny. People are being funny. If people are making jokes and being funny and playful with language, they're being incredibly creative and they're showing mastery over the language, even at a young age. And all of this ensures that the classroom is a safe space. They can engage in creative thinking, express themselves, come up with their ideas, share their ideas with everyone, and that only creates such a wonderful environment for learning. So, how and when to use in class? I mean, whenever you like. As I said, you can use the different cards with different levels. Adapt, 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 adapt. Use your ideas. Use them as a springboard. You don't have to use them as is. Use it as an idea. It's like, okay, I can do that, but I might change this. I might do this with my teens instead of my young learners. 100%, why not? You can use them as warmers and fillers, so you print them off, you've got them there, bring them out to warm up a class. Why not? Fill, why not? Because they're meaningful. It's not just a game of hangman or something we're doing just to fill the time. It's going to be developing skills, so it's a very worthwhile warmer and filler. You can choose them as an activity to support something you're teaching in the lesson, to support that language learning objective. You might be deciding that you want to actually develop this competency more, so you might choose a particular card to develop that particular life competency. Or you could give your students choice, okay? This goes back to, I think, on the first day when Savannah was talking about adaptive learning and differentiation. Choice, giving them a choice. You know, which car? We're going to do creative thinking, but which activity do you want to do? Choose one. Or everyone in the class, maybe in groups, chooses different ones. So they might choose a different car to work on in different groups. They could choose their own competency. Which one do you want to develop, critical thinking skills today or creative thinking skills? I would do that with slightly older learners. There's lots of ways you can do it. This is not an exhaustive list. It's not sort of like you have to do it in this order. I would suggest with our younger learners, building up the stages. Remember the core competencies and the components. So don't just go in with the heaviest one to begin with. But, you know, fit it into your class, fit it into your learners' needs. If you can, give them an element of choice and have fun with it. And just to show you with adults and how it overlaps, this is critical thinking. I use this with trainer training at the end of a training, the trainer session, to get the trainers to reflect on the activity they've done. And this ties in with learning to learn. So learning to learn and critical thinking are also tied together. Okay, so you can use it if you have a teacher development program within your school, or you want to, you know, try stuff out in class, you can train yourselves up. You can just be bold, reflect, try stuff out, and enjoy. download your free activity cards from our website, have a look at the brochures, and I hope that's been useful. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Laura, so much for that really practical, hands-on talk. That was fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you.
So you had lots of comments in the chat. People were really interacting. You couldn't see it, but I'll tell you that people were really interacting. I love the idea of comparing the elephant with the pizza. Because I felt myself thinking about it, like, oh, okay, how could I compare? Like, they're both round.
It really does make you think a bit harder, doesn't it?
It does. It was really good. People really enjoyed it. And we have a couple of questions, if that's all right.
Sure.
Okay. So this one is more of a technical question, but a definition question, actually. I liked it because I myself had to think about it. So we'll exercise what you taught today. So there's a question here that's asking the difference between competence and competency, and their plurals.
It's a competence. I think because competence is uncountable. Uh-huh. I'm making this up. Going by instinct, and I would say that a competency is something that we can count. So we've got these different competencies. We can define each of them individually.
Uh-huh.
That's what my answer would be. But if you want, talk to the research team.
Can I read my research? Because I think it's important. I didn't even
Please
know.
Do.
Nobody here at the studio knew, so we Googled it, and it's fine. But I think it's important for people to know because we get confused a lot, especially non-native speakers. So competence refers to an individual's capacity to perform job responsibilities. And competency focuses on an individual's actual performance in a particular situation.
Oh, there you go. That's better than mine. Yeah,
yeah, that's it. Fantastic.
Yeah, I'm going to
so
remember that.
So now you know. So we are actually talking here about competencies, right?
Yes.
With the Y. Fantastic. And there's one more question.
Sure.
That I really was intrigued by it, and I thought it was really interesting. In what way can we help motivate passive or shy learners in contributing to critical, creative thinking activities, especially those with limited vocabulary?
Okay. So, yeah, I mean, I think this is one of the reasons that I love doing these types of, like, elephant and pizza or any creative things, and this idea that there's it takes a while, but creating a space that's safe where their ideas for originality are praised because it makes them feel really, really good. I'll give you an example if I have time. This is from a teens class I had, and they were A2 level, and they were like 15, 16 years old, and we had some strong, confident students, we had some very shy students, and we had some, like, not very motivated, I'd rather go shopping or do something else students. And it was a vocabulary lesson, and we were looking at prefixes and suffixes, and I wanted them to understand that, you know, all language is created, and that they could have some input, and that if you got the wrong suffix, but the meaning was right, people would understand you. And one of the students came up with, we were looking at the word beautiful and the full bit of it. Uh-huh. And she went, does that mean we could say beautyless? And I just thought, well, no, you can't. But I didn't say that. I said, well, if you can come up with a meaning for it, why not?
Mm-hmm.
And so she really thought, and she went, well, I do have a meaning for it. And I went, okay, what is it? She went, well, we always say the opposite of beautiful is ugly, but if you're not beautiful, it doesn't mean you're ugly. You just might be beautyless.
Wow.
And I had one of those goose pimple moments.
Uh-huh.
And I went, that's absolutely amazing. I said, that's amazing because you've come up with a meaning and a word. She went, will that go in the dictionary? And I said, well, maybe if you start using it and then other people start using it and it spreads around the world, it might go in the dictionary. And then she said, will I get paid for it? And I had to say no. But you know what? From that moment, and it was a quiet moment, just me and her, her confidence soared and she started contributing to class more because she'd seen that just by that little bit of thinking, being a bit creative, getting such positive feedback, even with a wrong answer, that her contribution was valued.
Yeah.
She felt her whole attitude changed. She was so motivated after that, and she did really well. So there you go. That worked.
Brilliant. Yeah. Thank you. I love that. I'm gonna start using Beautylist. Thank you. Thank you, Laura, once again for your really inspiring talk. Thank you very much.
Very welcome. Have a great rest of the day, everybody.